So I'll talk about the title of my talk is the Bergman kernel approach to the Bourguignon minimal inequality and LP functionals. And this is some joint work with Professor Rubinstein. And so I want to fix some notation before I begin. So just ignore this column because I don't think I have time to talk about functions. So K is going to denote the convex body, S is going to be used to denote a symmetric convex body, K circ is the polar. So, you know, oh, there is a for all X and K missing there. Absolute value of K will denote the volume, BK the barycenter, MK the Mahler volume, and TK the tube domain, so it's like Rn cross product, like Rn Cartesian product of K. B2n is the usual n-dimensional ball in Rn, and K subscript superscript n is like a Cartesian product of K with itself.
Sorry for this. Do you assume that the origin belongs to the interior of the box?
I don't.
You don't?
No.
But doesn't in that way, don't you, will you get that the polar of a polar is K again?
Yeah, you will not.
You will not?
Yeah.
You don't mind it?
Not yet.
Okay.
Yeah, because I usually translate by the barycenter, so for now it's
okay.
Just, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and I put the definitions here so that people remember it. So in particular, I want to emphasize that for the Mahler volume, I'm going to use this n factorial here because this way it's multiplicative. So the Mahler volume of K times L is just the product of two volumes. So we don't have to worry about factorials. Alright, and so there are these famous conjectures by Mahler, like 1939, that for a symmetric convex body, the Mahler volume is lower bounded below by 4n, where it should be, and for in general it should be bounded below by this number there, which is the Mahler volume of this simplex, like translated, so that it's centered at the origin, and this is approximately, I mean, asymptotically e to the n. And these are still open, but with this theorem, first proved by Bourguignon and Milman in 1987, that at least there is some constant that doesn't depend on dimension, so that, you know, the Mahler volume is bounded below by Cn for all convex bodies and all dimensions. And we have several proofs, like Milman gave another proof next year, like 1988, and then by Cooperberg, Nazarov, Yiannopoulos, Bauris, and Ritchie, and two proofs by Burns recently. But I'll focus on the Nazarov proof. So, alright, so the reason why I want to focus on the Nazarov proof is that all of these proofs work for symmetric convex bodies. So they prove the theorem for a symmetric convex body, for all symmetric convex bodies, and then using this symmetrization trick, they get a bound for all convex bodies, and this comes from a theorem of Rogers and Seffert, like from the 50s, that, you know, if we take a convex body K that contains the origin, and we consider this convex hull of K and negative K, then this gives a symmetric convex body that contains K, and the volume is bounded from above by 2n times the volume of K. And so it follows as a corollary from that that, you know, if we have a lower bound than the Mahler volume of symmetric bodies, then we immediately get a lower bound for all bodies, but we have to divide the constant by 2. But Nazarov's proof, using the Bergman kernel, so Nazarov proved this bound specifically by pi cube over 16, which is approximately 1.9, and I think Professor Potsky gave another proof of the same theorem, like by another method, but still using Bergman kernels. And
no, I don't think I really get another proof.
Yeah,
it's just some aspects of Nazarov.
But it's the
same
bound
of whatever.
All right. So I don't know. But Nazarov, on the final lines of his paper, predicts that the same proof would work for any convex body. And this would be without using the symmetrization trick. Like, it would just, someone would be able to carry out all the details in a similar manner and get this bound pi over 4, which is not as good as, you know, what one would get from the symmetrization trick, but still, it's interesting to do. So, my talk, I'll talk about two things. First of all, how to actually carry out the details, so we only encounter one difficulty doing this, and so I'll explain what the difficulty is and what at least what we did to solve it, and then I want to talk about some nice definitions that came up from this work, and it's some LP variants of the Mahler volumes that really give a better approximation to the Mahler problem. Alright, so Nazarov's proof can be realized like in three steps. The first step is that we have a really good, a very explicit formula for the Bergman kernels of tube domains. So TK is a tube domain, is like Rn times K, and was ordered by the 60s and more explicitly in 2005. The formula for the Bergman kernels was explicitly computed. And so in particular on the diagonal for A in the interior of K, we get this integral, which is just a real thing, like it contains no complex numbers. The second step is to, so first of all, we would like to multiply the Bergman kernel with the volume of K squared, because call this BK because it behaves a little bit better. So for example, BK is an affine variant. And also we have this inequality connecting P and M, first given by Nazarov for symmetric bodies, then by Hultgren in a more general setting of functions that are centered at the origin. And then we reformulate it in terms of B and added the upper bound. The upper bound is not interesting for the proof of the Bruguin-Neumann, but I think it's interesting in general, as we'll see in a while. So this just follows from Jensen's inequality. And the third step is to construct a holomorphic function on the tube domain that evaluates at one, say at the 2-1 at the Poiret center on the diagonal, and then depending on what the setting is, we have a different constant. Like for symmetric bodies, it should be like pi cube over 16, and in general pi over 4. And I'll explain where these two numbers come from. But this would give the desired bound, because this would give a bound on B, and by this lemma, a bound on B would give a bound on M, just by multiplying by pi to the n. Alright, and one observation here is that we have those truss terms e to the on that are sub-exponential dimension, and I want to explain in the next slide why those things don't matter, so like, and how to get rid of them. So first of all, B is multiplicative, so this is another similarity between B and M. And so this means that if we have a lower bound on B that is of the type C to the n times some sub-exponential terms on dimension, then we can get rid of all those terms by the following trick. Just by using this multiplicative property of B, we can we have the same bound of Km, but B of Km is B of K to the m power, and so we can take the nth root and send m to infinity, and then those truss terms will just go away, and we're left with a constant with C.
Can you remind me?
Yes.
B, is that the Bergman kernel?
Yes.
B is the
Bergman kernel times the volume of K squared. And this is an affine variant, like M is an affine variant, and also it has this multiplicative property. Alright, and so the idea for bounding B due to Nazarov was to use Hermander's del Bar theorem to construct a holomorphic function that evaluates to one at the origin. So since this is symmetric, we know that the bar center is just the origin, and give this upper bound on the L2 norm of F, which has sometimes, so the first term is S squared, which we need, because B is not the Bergman kernel, B is the Bergman kernel times the volume of the body squared. So we want this term. This 16 over pi squared is the constant we're trying to prove for. Then we have a term e to the 2n delta times a constant plus 2n log sigma. But this is for all delta in 0 close to 0 and all sigma close to 1. So we can take delta to 0 and sigma to 1. And so this term goes away. And we have some truss terms that are sub-exponential to dimension, which we just described how to get rid of. And finally, we have this quotient big R over small r squared, where big R is a ball, the radius of a ball containing S, and small r is the radius of the ball contained in S. And so the only term we want to deal with is this R over R squared. And to do this, Nazarov uses John's theorem. So since everything is an affine invariant, M is an affine invariant, B is an affine invariant, care about affine transformations, and so by John's theorem, by applying an affine transformation, we can make sure that the convex body is contained between two balls of whose radii, the quotient of the radii is bounded above by square root n. And so in particular, this is also, this r over r here is also sub-exponential to dimension, and so all the terms from here, they go away. And we're left with a bound we need for the symmetric property. And just one more comment on Nazarov's proof is that to get this L2 bound on F, he's applying Hermander's theorem on the tube domain on some bump function, which I don't want to get into more details about, and the weight function is given by this phi, small phi, where the big phi is the conformal map between the symmetric strip, where the imaginary values are between negative 1 and 1, and the unit ball. And the reason this 16 over pi squared shows up in the proof is because exactly the derivative of this conformal map at the origin is pi over 4. So if you take pi over 4 and you square it, you get pi squared over 16. And then you invert that and you get 16 over pi squared. So if we want to do this in the non-symmetric setting, because this inner product between z and t will no longer lie in this strip of 1 to negative 1, we know that 1 will be an upper bound still, but negative 1 may not be the lower bound. So we have to go all the way to negative infinity. And so for the non-symmetric setting, we would have to change this conformal map from the half space where the imaginary part is less than or equal to 1 to the unit ball, and the derivative of the map would change, and this is where the different constant comes from. So, all right, so in general, if we want to do the same thing, there is a problem. Like, here I just explained that one could really do the same thing and get a bound like this one. But now we need to make sure that this quotient r over r has a good bound, which is, in general, we cannot do because John's theorem for non-symmetric bodies says that we can't find an affine transformation so that AK is contained between two balls of radius r, and small r and big r, so that the quotient is less than or equal to n. But it doesn't guarantee that the Paris center will be contained in, say, in the maximal ellipsoid. So if the Paris center is not contained in the maximal ellipsoid, then taking the polars would give really bad bounds. So this would destroy several parts of the proof. So that's the problem with the non-symmetric setting, that we need to find a way to control this R of R. And for us, the solution was to just let R depend on K. So we actually don't need to use John's theorem. And the observation is that for powers of K, we can choose the same R as, you know, as RK. And for the big R, we can take square root m of RK, because if K is contained in a ball of radius RK, the KM will be contained in a ball of radius square root m RK. And so this shows how to choose R in higher in products of K. And so having this observation in mind, we can let R depend on K so that we get this bound. And now, as I described before, we don't have 16 over pi squared here, we have 4 to the power of n. And this 4 to the power of n comes from this fact that we have to change the conformal map in general, so that we go from the half space now, instead of the symmetric strip, to the ball of radius 1. And this map has derivative at the origin equal to a half, which means that at the bound for f, it will show up as 1 half squared, which is 1 over 4, and then this inverted, which is just 4. Alright, so this f, because b is a Bergman kernel, this gives a lower bound on b. And gives this lower bound here, and k squared is gone because it was k squared is in the definition of b, and the rest of the terms are there. The 1 over 4 to the n we need. The other term with the delta and the sigma we can get rid of by taking delta to 0 and sigma to 1. And since this is a bound for all convex bodies in all dimensions, we get the same bound for the product of K. And now we know how they transform when we take products. So we can replace RKN by RK and big RKN by square root M RK. And then in this last expression here, we can take the nth root, and this part is now a constant. And 1 over m is sub-exponential, so everything will go to 1, except this 1 over 4. So we don't really need John's theorem. We can just let things depend on k, more things. In fact, we can even let more things depend on k, but I don't have much time to talk about it, so I'll just skip this part. And I want to focus on some observation that comes from this proof, that we have an explicit formula for the Bergman kernel, so we have an explicit formula for P. And in particular, we can write P like this. And if we introduce this HK1, which is like an L1 version of the, like, I mean, this is like the Laplace transform, but it looks like an L1 version of the support function, then we can rewrite BK as like that, which looks a lot like the Mahler volume. Because if we had the support function here, this would be n factorial the volume of the polar, which is exactly like times k is exactly the Mahler volume. So B behaves, we saw that B has similarities with M, and now we wrote it in a form that really resembles M, like the Mahler volume. And the observation is that we can do it this more generally. So we can define those LP versions of the support function, and then define some LP versions of the Mahler volumes by this definition. So so that for p equals infinity, we just have the maximum over the inner products, which would give exactly what we've defined as the Mahler volume above. And the nice thing about this MP is that now we can generalize the previous lemma. So recall that we had this inequality for B and M. And now B is exactly a multiple of M1. And so we can restate this inequality using M1 and M as its own in the second inequality here. And this inequality can be generalized for all p, so that we get better approximations of m. And the observation here is that as p goes to infinity, we really get better and better inequalities because this limit goes to 1. And in particular, like for any convex body, as if we take the limit of those MP volumes, then they converge to the Mahler volume.
Was the inequality on the previous page? What does it become in the limit?
In the limit?
Let's P tend to infinity in this.
Yes.
Okay, then the right hand side is the Mahler volume, the left hand side is the Mahler volume times 1. Okay.
Right. So, so this generalizes the previous lemma, and okay, and so it has many similarities to MP, has many of the same properties as M has. So, for example, they are invariant under the action of GLN, and also if we take K and we move it so that it's centered to the origin, then this expression here is a complete affine invariant, like even under translations. But in general, this is not invariant under polarity like the Mahler volume, because this is no longer a duality operation. Like, okay, so we lose duality, but that's not a big deal. Alright, but we can say something more that really resembles the Mahler volume. First of all the translations of K by a point in the interior have finite MP volume, but like if we translate by something that is not in the interior, then we get infinity. Moreover, we can compute exactly what the derivatives of those maps are, and we can also compute the second derivatives and show that this map is strictly convex. And in particular, this implies that since they're strictly convex and outside of a compact set, they are exactly infinity. So they must have a unique minimizer. So we get the existence of Santalon points for all those MP functionals. So there exists a unique point in the interior that minimizes MP over all translations, similarly to the Mahler volume. And it's exactly the point where the barycenter of the support function vanishes, of the P support function vanishes.
What is the B there in the
B
in the middle?
Yes.
B in the lemma in the middle, yeah. No,
Santalo points generalize to this setting, and it's also multiplicative, so this means that we can get rid of trust terms. Alright, and so maybe some examples. One can explicitly compute, I mean, I don't know, I'm not sure if this can be simplified for a large P, but at least for P equals 1, there is a very nice formula that was also discovered by Professor Votsky in terms of Bergman kernels, but here M1 just reformulated a little bit. It's a really nice formula for P equals 1. For higher P, I don't know if the cube has a nice expression. Yes, we haven't found something. Now for the two balls, we have an expression in terms of the modified Bessel functions. So the modified Bessel function is given by this series, and one can compute the NP of P to N for all P and all N in terms of an integral of this function. And it's a nice expression because you can put it in a computer and it can give you an estimate of what this will be. And this is a work in progress, but it should be the case that asymptotically the Mahler, the LP volume of P to N should look like this. But we don't have a proof for this yet. Another interesting example is the simplex. So the simplex, but you have to move it so that it's centered at the origin. And you can compute, say, M1 of the two-dimensional simplex. We've also computed M1 of the three-dimensional, but I didn't add it here. And you can see that M1 of the simplex is less than M1 of the cube. And again, this is also a work in progress, but there is good indication that asymptotically the MP volume of the simplex should be given by this nice expression there. And okay, so one can make conjectures that for symmetric bodies those MP are minimized by the cube, and in general they're minimized by the simplex. And by the previous lemma, if those conjectures are true, then they imply the Mahler's conjecture, because if they're true for all P, then we can take P to infinity. And this may be easier because there's only one conjecture minimizer, namely the cube. So people say maybe, you know, the existence of multiple minimizers make the problem harder. Right, and the first conjecture for P equals 1 was also conjectured by Professor Votsky in terms of Bergman kernels, previous paper.